manufacturers, as long as those manufacturers meet minimum threshold contracts to for government procurement with the United States. So the question then becomes, which countries have similar agreements, and as it similar agreements to the NAFTA, meaning that these countries can be considered as domestic manufacturers. And as it turns out, there's about 129 countries in the world that are considered as domestic manufacturers for government procurement in the United States, as long as they meet minimum thresholds. So these are the countries that are colored in on the map. And going on from there, which countries are not considered domestic manufacturers under similar treaties? And it's Brazil, Russia, India, China. It also includes other countries such as Indonesia, Egypt, South Africa. And these countries don't yet have the types of contracts, the types of treaties to be considered as domestic manufacturers for U.S. government procurement purposes. So that leads us to our policy options for what to do with the Buy American Act. We essentially have three. It's to keep the status quo, keep the Buy American Act as it stands, completely eliminate it, or keep the relevant provisions that are the advantages that Michael had talked about, and get rid of the disadvantages. So our recommendation is get rid of the Buy American Act's disadvantages while trying to keep its main advantages. And we would recommend focusing on national security, such as the Berry Amendment, for military procurement, for the necessities of government procurement, but not extending it to the entire government. And while also considering whether or not NASCO and similar entities would want to help businesses in Mexico and Canada perhaps have lower thresholds to contract with the government. Of course, that might not be as feasible, given that if you have a small contracting capacity, you may not be able to contract with the U.S. federal government. But those would be some options. Keep the Buy American Act positive advantages and try to eliminate the disadvantages, while also trying to introduce lower thresholds for contracting with the government, while also considering whether these other countries, Brazil, Russia, India, China, would want to have contracting capacities with the federal government. And with that, any questions? Thank you for your time.
Okay, so these 129 countries that are exempt, did you guys learn anything? How were they made exempt in the 1930s legislation?
No. Treaty since then. So you'll see here the WTO-GPA. That's the government procurement add-on to the WTO agreement, and all the countries that signed it, their government procurement is open between them. And so that's the green countries there, basically Europe. Bilateral agreements, we have a lot of bilateral agreements that open up our government procurement with different countries. Least developed countries are exempt automatically. NAFTA, of course, with Canada and Mexico. And this CAFTA that was accredited to the Dominican Republic. So they came on over time, these got exempt. At first, the idea was all protectionists, make it Buy American. But then what it's basically become is not let's buy American, it's let's exclude some of the big powerhouses and our closest allies.
It's important to know that they're exempt at different levels. So for Canada to get a service contract, the contract has to be over $25,000 for them to be able to apply for it. For Mexico, it has to be $75,000. NAFTA is typically the nicest. After that, they shoot up to $200,000 before a country can apply. And then least developed countries, it's questionable how many companies have the capacity to actually apply for their U.S. contract.
And did y'all look at anything like the Trans-Pacific Partnership and some new agreements being discussed right now?
It was still in flux, and so we actually decided to not focus too much attention on it. Because we knew that it was being debated. We do know that there is a government
seems China might be opened up.
Right. Yeah. That was interesting too. I mean, I know less about this than I do about the harmonization and regulation issues, so I think, again, you guys hit all the really high points, and I learned a lot by listening to you. But again, it seems like it's a political issue. It's back to elected officials and responding to their constituents. And one of the issues that comes up repeatedly in our conversations is that, yes, okay, so free trade agreements aren't always free. There's costs to them. Some people lose, some people win. And usually, like you said, the lower income, lower educated people are the ones that usually end up losing more because those jobs go away. But then when you start talking about opportunities for those people to take training courses or to get certified in a skill or to move 30 miles away from where they live currently to be closer to a job that is available and they don't want to, then you start dealing with the issue of, well, there are jobs out there to be had. They don't want the jobs. They want their old job. And so the job's not coming back, so they sit around and bitch about it. And they don't really want to do the work necessary to get an opportunity to, you know, move on and have their family career path, you know, kind of shot in a different area. So that's what happens in our meetings, is people say, well, the big problem is we've got to admit that there are problems with the system, but then provide a plethora of opportunities for them to be retrained into a job that they can have very quickly. But then is the desire there for them to actually go through the training and have their job.
Yeah.
So it's a really difficult, it's not a really fun thing to talk about publicly. People don't want to be on the record saying stuff like, those guys just want to sit around and complain, and they don't want to get off their butts and get a new job.
Yeah.
So, you know, no one wants to be the one with the microphone on their face saying that. So it's a difficult situation. And it continues to be because of a lot of those similar issues.
What do you think are some of the solutions that seems like a really tough issue that we...
Oh yeah, I mean, I think that's why it's still going on, is that there's not a lot of easy solutions. I mean, you can't force someone to want to change and do a better job. And I understand people not wanting to move, you know, 30 or 40 miles away because maybe they're not near their family and things like that. But that's the biggest problem, I think, with this, is that there are jobs in free trade agreements that are going to be lost. There's no way getting around it. But there have been 400 million, I think 40 million jobs created since the passage of NAFTA. And I think there were 278,000 that were lost. So you're looking at 40 million versus 278,000. Well, that's a win for most people, you know what I mean? But those 278,000, that's your uncle, it's your grandfather, it's your brother, it's your whatever. Everyone knows somebody that's in that 278,000 jobs that were lost. So it becomes very near and dear to your heart. NAFTA was a failure, but that no one's thinking about all the 40 million jobs that were created. So it's a tough situation.
Yeah. Well, one of the questions that I have, there seems to me that there's an argument that I never hear it articulated, and it comes out with the students. But when you hear the criticism of NAFTA, and you look at a place like Guanajuato, which is growing exponentially, it seems to me that the question is not, has NAFTA failed the United States because all these industries are moving to Mexico? The question is, all these industries were going to move somewhere. Wouldn't we rather have them
close by, next door? Because it keeps jobs in the U.S. That's exactly, and I was actually about to say that I just read an article that was talking about, but for NAFTA, we could have lost the auto industry entirely to China. No jobs anywhere. But because the jobs went to Mexico, there's still the supply chain. The making of an auto is so integrated in all three of our countries' supply chains that because a bulk of them might have moved to Mexico, but because they're in Mexico, there are jobs in the U.S. that are supplying those automakers in Mexico, and so it's kept, you know, hundreds of thousands of jobs in the United States for the auto industry that would, the whole thing would have picked up and moved to China, but for NAFTA. But people only focus on the loss, and so it's an education campaign. It's something that NASCO is working on. And we're having a meeting on May 13th, and that's why we can't be at your graduations or clapping you on, but in Washington, D.C., and it's a campaign. I mean, Rachel passed out the stuff that the All Trade is personal. We're trying to help educate constituents and members of Congress and their staff about the importance of international trade and international trade agreements on everyday life, and having some real-world positive examples and being able to meet almost with a preemptive strike, saying, yes, there are bad things that happen with these free trade agreements, but the overwhelming majority of things that happen are good, and they create jobs. That some people are going to lose their jobs, so we've got to figure out, I think NASCO's new strategy is admit that people lose their jobs, but we have got to get into those communities and have training programs readily available, teach them about the opportunities out there, and hope that that's effective in getting them to go into a different career path, because there are jobs out there to be had.
Right.
Right.
But
so much of it is the education and the socio, like those first few slides that y'all showed. I mean, just the how people grew up and their families and their ways of thinking, and that, oh, truck driving is a bad thing, or oh, if you're a truck driver, like stereotype, you know.
Yeah.
And so there's so many stereotypes attached to a lot of the trade transportation jobs that are out there. So that's a big thing that we've kind of embarked on in the workforce area that ties into, you know, trade agreements and harmonization and the movement of goods. And that starts at home. It starts, you know, when kids are young and in school and trying, I mean, there's a whole, I mean, it's an education at like every level, not just, you know, to government and congressional staffers. So that's an even bigger
right.
challenge.
Mm-hmm. And when we were thinking about, when I wrote the recommendations about, you know, choosing better options that aren't distortionary, one of my big thoughts was things like worker retraining. You know, people do lose their jobs and they're low skilled, they don't have many options. Come up with new industries, new areas, and help them learn how to do them.
Yeah.
Things like EITC to improve their chances of getting a job and keeping it and having a living wage, that kind of thing. And that way, not only is it more politically feasible, you're able to actually get something done, but also you're not harming a sector even while you help everyone as a whole.
Right. You have to take care of the people you're hurting.
Right.
Like, to me, what's been missing in all these free trade agreements is they, maybe it is for the greater good, but you have all the negative ramifications and all, I mean, it takes 2 seconds. It's very difficult with the media. When you have a 20-second interview, it's easy to tear it down and say, my dad lost his job, and now we're poor, we can't afford anything, and all that. It's so easy to do. But then to explain to people why, okay, yes, that's horrible, but here's all the stuff that happened. That can't be done in 20 seconds. I mean, that takes a 3-hour special, you know, that no one's ever going to watch because no one really cares that much. So it's a really hard battle to fight. And so we're trying to do these campaigns and go into the local level and teach people about there's good and bad. With the bad, let's have a plan. And I like your idea of kind of sort of removing the bulk of the legislation. I never thought about removing the bulk of it and keeping the things in line that would achieve the benefits of them and take away the, I don't know how you do that though, because it's sort of, once it's negotiated, it's a package deal, you gotta, you know, vote it up or down. But that'll give me some thought, like for a long time, on how we could maybe structure an argument to achieve both, to keep the good stuff in and figure out a way to handle the bad stuff. But we're working on this, and it's one of these, like the harmonization of regulation, nothing's been done on it over several decades because it is such a hard problem to solve. But again, I think we can take your presentation. You guys did an A+ again, did a great job, and I think we can get this to our members and we can use it. So you okay? Well, if your time frame is to have this done by the time you graduate, then if you can get us the report and an executive summary, then we can certainly take it to D.C. and hand it out to members of Congress and their staff and the people that are at that meeting, and that'll be a great first step. And then we can distribute it to our membership beyond that.
And Tiffany, one of the things that I'm hearing is a real stress on the executive summary.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That's part of the
report. Not to give you extra work, because I know, but yeah, and be, you know. Be bold in these executive summaries. You know, like, don't, like, if you come up with stuff that's really a problem, put it in there, and the challenges, because I think, again, you guys probably didn't know much about this when you started, and it's such a massive issue. And even with Canada and Mexico, they might be the exempt countries, but there's country boards and labeling fights now, and there's a softwood lumber debate, there's all this stuff going on that Canada even, so Mexico can't even, they're exempt countries, but they can't even get, I mean, there's still so much fighting over smaller, very industry-specific issues. There's a lot of work to be done, but I think y'all did a fantastic job. Really, truly, yeah.
Thank you.
Both groups.
Do you think something akin to the information that we pointed out to in our presentation would be clear enough for to guide the summary?
Yeah, I think so. Like the slides themselves, you mean, and what you've listed in there?
Yeah. And I don't want to say anything because your professors may have very different opinions on this than I do, so obviously do what they want.
Yeah.
But I find that even executive summaries, like if they're 4 or 5 pages long,
right.
people are so busy these days that I even like bullet points. at like executive summary, but just boom, 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 here's the problem, here's our recommendations, or whatever, however you want to structure it, because I feel like if you get too much prose in there, people aren't, they look at it and think, ugh, this is like a book, even though it's small, but bullet points, they're more apt to maybe take it on an airplane, that's what I do, and read them, and they want the highlights, so you don't even need a lot of backup. I feel like backup information is not even necessary in this world anymore, because if you need to read the backup, a lot of people have already made up their minds by the time they get to that. Mm-hmm. But again, this may be totally opposite of what your professors think.
No, but the whole point of this is to work for the our client.
Okay.
I mean, you say something about some of these projects and say that the students probably should speak to this more so, but I don't really want to speak for it, but I think there is some sense that you get as you work on this about how far this is. And what Bill and I say essentially to lots of folks is, yeah, these are really important questions, and if they were easy, if they were, they've been answered long ago, they wouldn't be sitting around for you to try, because you do have, especially in the My America, you have all these kind of counterfactuals where you can't really get data. You have data where we can't know who actually is involved in bidding for the procurement. But to me, the big surprise that I had no idea about, because I had no substantive knowledge in this area, were the things that sort of dawns on everyone that there are 129 countries that
I didn't know that either. Yeah. I didn't know that either.
And if you really look at it, I think it's really keeping, what's it really doing? It's really, you could say this is the Keep China Out legislation.
Yeah,
function.
Yeah. So, like, honestly, yeah, that was one of my big takeaways. This is not even a Buy America, this is not a Buy America, it's a Keep China Out thing. I mean, exactly. Because if there's 129 countries that are exempt.
No,
I mean, that's,
yeah, there are no
trading.
Right. I think the next one, because we were talking about that at kind of the end, I think that will be in the report. That was something that sort of dogs ought to discover these surprises and perspectives that don't come about until the last few months. Or
and as you're saying that, I mean, I think maybe an argument, like, is so many people throw the Buy America language around. I'm pro-USA, I'm pro-Buy America, and they don't even know what they're talking about, but I think some of those people that hear in the news, they think, I want American products, it's good for my uncle and my brother that lost their jobs, I want this back, I want us to make America great again, I hate to use those phrases, you know, made us great again, and go back to that time in life. But I think if, I almost feel like a headline, something along the lines of, you know, something, here's what I'm trying to say. I feel like a lot of those people, if they knew that 129 countries around the world were considered American, they would be like, well, what's this all about anyway? Why do we care about this? If 129 countries are considered American, then what am I all Buy America for? Because you're buying 129 countries is what you're doing. Like, I almost think that might be a really compelling argument, is that this isn't really Buy America. Don't think that when you say Buy America, you're buying USA products, you're buying 129, you're buying 130 countries' products. And most people probably be like, well, how many more countries are there out there in the world than 130? I mean, it's almost the whole world, you know? Except for China, Brazil, India, you know, the ones that the main competitors of ours. So I think that might be the most compelling thing that comes out of this, is that if all those people that are like, pro-USA, Buy America, knew that they were buying, you know, Mexico and Canada didn't count in that, and all the other 127 countries didn't count.
Well, that argument goes the other way, too, doesn't it?
What?
Well, it cuts the other way in that one can say, well, okay, so if all we're really doing is excluding certain of our key competitors, then what's the harm?
Okay. Well, okay, sure. But I think a lot of the people are pro-Buy America because they think it's just USA products.
Yes.
So if you could say, no, it's USA plus 129 other countries, they might go, oh.
I agree.
The smarter people,
you just have to be aware that it can be flipped on its head.
I think the more intelligent people would say, who cares about 130? It's great that we're keeping out China and stuff. But I think a lot of the people that are really passionate about it don't have a clue that they're passionate about 130 countries of opportunity. They think they're passionate about one. Mm-hmm. And I think if they were educated on that, maybe, I don't know.
Well, I think the counter to that is that the jobs that are going to go, and the fact that we've excluded these countries doesn't keep these jobs from going elsewhere. So you still have the same distortionary
effects. Right, right, yeah, totally. And the bottom line, too, is what we've learned on these two, well, not on harmonization regulations, but on these issues, they're so emotional that the facts don't even matter. Like, people and even elected officials, they've made up their minds. You can go to them with fact after fact after fact to prove them wrong, to try to sway them, and they'll say, oh, I see all that, yes, I see, but no, I'm still gonna do, you know, they don't care about the facts, and that's an impossible situation to win right there, so.
Jane?
You have to have an emotional argument.
That was actually the point I was gonna bring up, it's mostly emotional. There's like a list of the most patriotic companies that are voted upon, and most of them don't actually produce their goods here.
Well, yeah, in some ways you'd argue that what the political process has done is to retain the Buy America rhetoric and essentially to largely undermine it, except for the fact that we aren't engaged in government procurement contracts with China.
Yeah. You guys can make a great, they have a great video where they Buy America and somebody hands you some Tanzanian coffee and like, yeah, this counts. Buy a lot of products from all those 129 countries.
Yeah, well, exactly.
Like,
I think something like that,
make
people like, oh, that's counted?
Oh, well, you could hold up your mug and say, today I'm drinking some water and buy a beer.
Well, I'll tell you, what I think you guys should do is go fill these up with beer and go and drink them, because you all did an amazing job. It was really awesome. I mean, that was great. It was really good job.
Why do you endorse this?
I would suggest that for those at the College Station location, though, that you do that after the drive.
Yeah. Oh, you're going back today?
Maybe just not that side.
Or at least the drive. Or the drivers. It's okay.
I'm watching all my other friends drive while I'm
You can work on the executive summary.
Along those lines, I was just going to say real quick, we're doing with Chrysler and our partners in Washington, another organization, we're putting together, they do a follow that freight brochure. And so they try to pick items that a lot of us use in our daily lives. And so like they've done almond butter, and they did a cherry from Washington to somewhere in Asia, and then they did the almond from somewhere to Germany, and so we said, let's do a North American piece. So we are teaming up with Chrysler, and we're doing the Dodge Charger, and we're looking at the route that it's taking from the Hemi plant in Saltillo, Mexico, and then the parts that are being made in the U.S., and then it's going up to their Brampton, Ontario plant, and just some of the stops it's going to make along the way, and how it's truly a North American car. And so we're hoping to have it all tied up and next week, but we're going to have that piece in Washington, and then Chrysler is giving us little candy or charger keychains to hand out with those. So things like that, you know, we're trying to kind of catch some.
Where are those keychains made?
That's a good question. You know, and a funny story, our lapel pin.
Oh my God, we got
So, you know, we're a nonprofit. I'm always looking for a great deal when we purchase our swag items. And a few years back, I purchased some that were made in China, and we had a man come up. We were in Mexico City at our conference, and he was like, look at the back of this, turn this over. This was made in China. Aren't you about North America? Why are you about, what is, you know, like just went off. And so I ended up
calling. Came to me first. I was like, Rachel did it.
Yeah, find Rachel. So I ended up like,
that doesn't say China.
What the difference in price is, and it was over three times more expensive to have them made in California through a producer I found, and that's what you're up against. And
what the story in Japan, or soon after the war, when at that time in Japan was not strictly quality, but we in the USA it was. So some place in Japan decided to brand themselves as USA, so they said they.
Really? Just the perception.
China, Texas.
I just realized we could have just scratched the CHI off and then made an NA for North America.
I just found new plastic baggies.
But who would think so anyway? But great job, you guys. Really, really, really good.
Okay, I have a few door prizes before we go.
Oh.
And I only have five, so.
Is it a Dodge Charger?
It is not. I'm not Oprah. There are no keys here.
Everyone gets a car.
Okay, so first question, who tell me what NASCO stands for.
Oh, wow, that's more than we've ever had in our whole lives.
Tiffany, you pick.
I don't know, ISIS.
North American Strategy for Competitiveness.
Awesome, ISIS. Okay, would you like a nice Windsor Essex mug? Or, hold on, or would you like a NASCO luggage tag?
Oh, this sounds really cool.
Wow.
Oh, I kind of want the luggage tag, actually.
That's acceptable. Okay, there you are. Okay. Next one, okay, nobody on the harmonization team can answer this. Okay, how many tanker inspectors does the state of Texas have?
Trace.
Good, okay. Okay, mug or luggage?
I'll take luggage.
Okay. Should have brought more luggage tags. I like it.
We travel a lot.
We'll talk about it then. Good. Well, I may have some more luggage tags, but I can make sure everybody has one. Okay, well, 129 countries was going to be one of mine, but that has been beat home now. Does anybody know where our annual reunion is going to be this year? Our big annual conference?
George W. Bush Center.
Oh, awesome. Okay. Get a mug. Okay. Tiffany, you have a question.
Now you go ahead.
Can we give it to the VIA day? Is that what it
is? Cool. I don't know. What are our three focus areas at NASCO? Anybody know that? What's one of them?
Public policy.
Transportation.
We'll give it to you. Supply chain and logistics.
Supply chain and logistics. Okay. Okay, mug. Okay, I've got one more. Okay. Oh, this one's.